Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Tanner Lectures on Human Values, a celebration of outstanding intellectual contributions of our Tanner lecturer, and also an occasion that brings our university community together and connects us more closely to the wider world of ideas. The Tanner Lectures were established at Cambridge University in 1978 and are hosted annually at 9 universities in the United States and abroad. They are named for a man who held higher education in the highest regard, a man who described the university, and I quote him, as absolutely the greatest creation of human existence. A creation, he said, with the greatest promise, the greatest help, the greatest meaning for finding what is true and what is valuable. Obert Clark Tanner built his life and his life's work around creating meaning and acknowledging value. An early entrepreneurial endeavor, making class rings in his mother's basement, grew into a remarkably successful career at the helm of O.C. Tanner Company, a leading manufacturer of employee recognition awards. His success in business enabled Mr. Tanner to live a life, in his words, of adventure and variety. With curiosity and energy, he broadened the scope of his intellectual and philanthropic interests, devoting himself to understanding and improving the human condition. He taught philosophy at the University of Utah for decades. He generously supported the arts and arts making, most notably through the design and construction of unique fountains, including Harvard's own Tanner Fountain outside the Science Center. And he made donations to create philosophy rooms in 11 different college and university libraries. But it is perhaps this contribution for which he is best known. He saw these lectures, and I quote him again, as a search for a better understanding of human behavior and human values. This understanding, he continued, may be pursued for its own intrinsic worth, but it may also eventually have practical consequences for the quality of personal and social life. And so every year we gather to celebrate universities, what they are and what they mean for humanity. We gather too to seek a deeper understanding of ourselves and of our place in the world. The Tanner Lectures are welcome and welcoming, an affirmation of our capacity to find meaning and value in a complex world. I hope they energize each of you as they energize me every year. I thank the Harvard Tanner Faculty Committee for appointing today's marvelous lecturer, and the staff of the Mahindra Humanities Center for planning today's event. And of course, I extend my deepest appreciation to Homi Bhabha, director of the center and our master of ceremonies today. I now invite Homi Bhabha to begin the day's events. Homi.
Thank you, President Faust, for your support and encouragement of these lectures. I want to thank the committee and all my colleagues and friends in the audience who have turned up yet again, they always do, for our occasions and for this very special event. Rowan Williams, it's a great pleasure to have you here today. If there is a contemporary theologian capable of justifying the ways of God to men, it must be Rowan Williams, Master of Magdalen College, Cambridge, and from 2002 to 2012, the Archbishop of Canterbury. In a remarkable early work, The Wound of Knowledge, first published in 1979, Williams found a voice and a vision that has over time shaped much of what he has had to say about God's ways. God asks not for heroes, but for lovers. Not for moral athletes, but for men and women aware of their need for acceptance, ready to find their selfhood in the longing for communion with an eternal other. What kind of binding, even blinding love, do men and women find for themselves or seek amongst themselves when they are in communion with God's otherness? Seems to me the question posed. In a later work, Wrestling with Angels in 2007, Williams raises a similar issue, but on this occasion, the question is posed from the perspective of man's otherness. If sociality is never mended in a final way, as he puts it, then we may ask, how can the recognition of and the negotiation with the networks of human alterity or difference be read as something to do with God? As his work makes its way along the via negativa, wrestling with angels, walking the knife edge between negation and creation in Dostoevsky 2008, Rowan Williams never fails to arrive at the commitments of faith in the public square, another title from 2012. And it is for this very reason that I am tempted to make an immodest inversion of Milton's phrase and suggest that Rowan Williams' true gift lies in explaining, perhaps not justifying, the ways of men to God. Empathy, the topic of Rowan Williams' Tanner lectures, has a long and rich genealogy in his writings. It is indeed one of the key words of his many dialogues with God on behalf of the rest of us. Without leaking the divine revelations he has for us today, I want to offer a glimpse of that genealogy. Empathy is an essential part of Williams's contemplative ideal, a crossroads of the sacred and the secular. Empathy's attention to irreducible differences may entail a self-dispossession and then a recovery of the self through the other. Empathy is shaped by a polyphonic gathering of guiding voices as diverse in his work as Augustine, Hegel, Vladimir Losky, Simone Weil, W.H. Auden, and Bakhtin, amongst a host of others. Empathy emerges from the contemplation of God's otherness, which speaks in the language of love. And if you read love for its grammar rather than its essence, William writes, you come to the conclusion, and I quote him, "What is to be loved is surely the absolute contingency, the mortality of a person, the person freed from the future that our egotistical imagination longs to project." If empathic love frees us from the sovereignty of the ego and its narcissistic, self-satisfied projections, then it is in recognizing the absolute contingency of the other that empathy endows the subject or object of love with the value of dignity. Although dignity is often seen as part of the indwelling, immanent spirit of the human, the true test of dignity lies in our recognition of the other's contingent present and choice. In his recent book, Human Dignity, George Kateb speaks movingly of the contingent future embedded in the very figure and practice of dignity. Human beings, he writes, are moved by a sense of dignity as of possibility or potentiality, of the unrealized, of the not yet. It is with an eye to empathy and dignity that time and time again, Williams implores us as humanists, as teachers, as scholars, as believers, as non-believers, to pay attention to language and meaning. Look carefully at the grammar of values and attitudes, he seems to say. Scrutinize the rhetoric of recognition and rights. Interpretation prescinds from the question of recognition, he puts it, as a set of signifiers systematically organized not determined by any individual decision or project, and challenges agents to reconceive their goal and interest in what is other. It is, I believe, Williams's profound study of the philology of everyday life, as witnessed in his reading of the grammar of love and its yield of empathy and dignity, that makes his theology a rare thing of grace and justice. And if a measure of the love of persons and things dwells in what is contingent, unexpected, and yet to come, could anyone have better expressed God's love's gift to God and man than these words from Gerard Manley Hopkins? All things counter, original, spare, strange, whatever is fickle, freckled, who knows how, with swift, slow, sweet, sour, a dazzle dim, he fathers forth, whose beauty is past change. Praise him. Thank you very much. Right.
President, friends, with such an introduction, I feel really rather intimidated about offering what I have to offer to you this afternoon, but I can only say thank you for the generosity with which I've been welcomed today, and indeed in my time here so far. And I must also express my thanks for the great honor conferred by the invitation to deliver these lectures in such distinguished company. Thank you all for attending and for what you will contribute to our collective thinking as these days go on. In an impressive and impassioned discussion of the impact of contemporary individualism, Sue Gerhardt argues that we need a shift in our approach to early years education. We know that we need to help children understand, she says, to help them trace feelings and actions to their roots, and to predict what might lie ahead for the child and for anyone they are observing or encountering. To help them mentalize, in the rather ungainly technical term sometimes used. But this is only part of the story. It is, of course, crucial to treat the child as a thinking subject, capable of recognizing others as thinking subjects. Yet it may be a lot less important than encouraging children to be open to the emotional state of another, to share the experience rather than simply to be able to locate it on an interpretative map. This is what is essential, says Gerhardt, to moral development. But both are kinds of mental activity associated with the development of the ventromedial prefrontal cortex in the right hemisphere of the brain, as you all know. An area, says Gerhardt, which is also involved in mind reading, irony, faux pas, reading others' affects, realizing deception, all forms of inference of other people's intentions. As the child becomes self-aware, builds up a reserve of pictures of itself and its actions and feelings, it has the raw material for simulation of others, representing for itself what is going on in another subject and recognizing both sameness and difference in that encounter. It is able to build on the activities now identified as those of mirror neurons in the brain, the processes in the brain which directly reflect processes going on in the brains of another as that other's experience is witnessed and digested. And if the parent is able to move on and enlarge the child's repertoire from mere intelligent simulation to a felt contact with the other's state of mind and emotion, this plays a central role in the child's acquisition of cooperative social habits. The entire developmental story is one of the extension and refinement of empathy, defined here as an awareness of the emotional condition of others that isn't simply a matter of mental recognition, of knowing that someone else is happy or unhappy without your own emotional condition being affected. Good parenting, parenting that acknowledges the reality of a child's emotional states and takes them seriously, is what nurtures a child into an empathic adult. And the lack of such parenting leaves the child devoid of essential resources for imaging themselves and so for imaging others. The brain's capacities will remain undeveloped in some important areas, and by adolescence, a child will have become seriously dysfunctional in relations of all kinds. If we want to address the violent or self-destructive lifestyles of so many, especially urban young people, we must focus more intently on the experience of parenting. And to mature in empathy is at the heart of an ethical culture for individuals and groups alike. Now, Sue Gerhardt's book is one of the best and most credible examples of a dramatically spreading tendency to see empathy as the key to ethical behavior. It's admirably careful not to oversimplify the issue, and as we'll see later, her account, I think, avoids some of the more difficult versions of the trend. But discussion, of course, is complicated by the fact that empathy as a concept is something of a newcomer to the language as well as to moral philosophy. Naturalized from the German Einfühlung, it's still a remarkably slippery as well as a remarkably fertile notion. And the rapid and brilliant development of a neuroscience capable of mapping the involvement of areas of the brain in affective states has given impeccable credentials to those who see empathy as a key to resolving major issues of ethical definition, as well as ethical education. If I were being a bit indiscreet, I would say that now, at long last, because scientists talk about empathy, other people with a sigh of relief feel they can talk about it as well. So, my Cambridge colleague Simon Baron Cohen, in his very attractive and influential 0 Degrees of Empathy, can propose that evil be redefined as empathy erosion, and that the essence of any action we call evil is to be found, quote, in turning another person into no more than an object. The analysis of non-empathic brain activity, utilizing the groundbreaking researches of Baron Cohen and his collaborators on autistic conditions, is combined here with equally innovative and important research on genetic patterns to argue that acts of human cruelty arise from underactivity in what's sometimes now called the empathy circuit of the brain. An underactivity which is itself rooted in genetic predisposition, triggered by one or more environmental factors. A sense of being threatened, ideology, conformity, and cultural sanction, and so on. Nonetheless, says Baron Cohen, this is not intended as a deterministic picture. Behavior and understanding can be modified. People who engage in dramatically unempathic behavior can't be assumed to have lost their capacity of sensing or sharing the emotional state of others. And consciously working to cultivate empathy, providing opportunities for people deeply divided by ideology or racial prejudice or religious fanaticism to hear and embrace the other's perspective, is potentially one of the most significant resources for the human future. Any problem immersed in empathy, says Baron Cohen, becomes soluble. Well, what I shall be arguing in these lectures, with due respect and appreciation for the intellectual elegance and creativity of the science involved, is that this judgment, as thus expressed, is in important respects seriously mistaken, and that it rests on both a faulty set of definitions and a narrowing down and privatizing of ethical discourse. Instead of identifying ethical education with the development of empathy, however exactly this is understood, I want to suggest that ethics is irreducibly a linguistic and cultural discourse in which issues of power are among the most central and troubling. A discourse also in which we must become aware both of what we can and of what we cannot understand in the experience of others, and learn how to comport ourselves with others precisely by examining this duality of what we know and what we don't. This points ultimately in the direction of a certain picture of the self, without which I believe ethics will become vacuous. But let's begin with the definitional question. Simon Baron Cohen identifies two aspects of empathy, cognitive and affective, early on in his survey. And throughout his book, is careful to distinguish between different sorts of empathic deficit. A cognitively limited subject, a person with an autistic spectrum disorder, for example, and Baron Cohen has done exemplary work on this, a cognitively limited subject may not know how to read the signals which would show most of us that a person was in distress or pain. But they're likely also to show distress themselves if they are made aware of such distress or pain. Conversely, a person whose cognitive apparatus is in perfect repair may behave in a way that indicates no emotional resonance with another's state, the extreme manifestation being the psychopath's indifference to the suffering of victims. Thus, there is, Baron Cohen argues, a difference between what he calls negative and positive empathy inhibition or malfunction. It's negative when it appears in the psychopath or the narcissist or even the borderline personality whose obsessiveness and self-preoccupation isolate them and damage those closest to them. It is positive, though it's a slightly odd use of the word, it's positive when, as in the autistic subject, this inhibition defends someone against uncontrollable anxiety and distress arising from the overload of sensory stimulus and the need for a wholly stable environment, a classic etiology for certain ASD conditions. Now, all this is indisputable as far as it goes, but the simple cognitive affective division appears less simple on closer examination. And the generalization that empathy erosion amounts to treating another as an object doesn't quite fit. The assumption is that to be acutely aware of the emotional impact of your activities is to be positively empathic. Baron Cohen uses as an example of non-empathic behavior the horrific story of mothers being forced to kill their own children by a militia group led by a woman in Uganda, as well as the record of an extermination camp survivor describing a prisoner being ordered to hang his closest friend. But these instances are emphatically not examples of treating another human being as an object. On the contrary, what makes them shocking is that they involve treating victims very much as subjects, capable, as objects are not, of being humiliated, mentally tortured, and traumatized. The perpetrator of outrages like these is entirely aware of the emotion generated by their action. The problem isn't that they don't know what emotions are generated. It's that they don't identify it as anything that causes them suffering or distress, and they almost certainly derive an emotional pleasure from what they do. The plain cognitive affective grid doesn't actually help us much here. We should have to say that the difficulty was not the absence of emotional awareness, but an inappropriate emotional response to someone else's pain. There are certainly examples of what seems to be straightforward emotional detachment, tuning out in the course of cruel or abusive behavior. And Baron Cohen rightly refers us to the professional behavior of an executioner or a doctor collaborating in an execution. But this looks like learned behavior rather than the erosion or malfunction of a natural capacity. It's not different in kind from what a surgeon would have had to learn, especially in the days before anesthetics, or even more immediately and familiarly, a parent removing a splinter from a child's foot. Raymond Tallis, physician and ethicist, one of Baron Cohen's most perceptive critics, rightly says, "No one could be a surgeon and empathize with the experience of the patients he or she operates on, or at least not while performing the operation." On top of this, there are, of course, examples of simple, casual cruelty, what we usually call unthinking, and which may indeed argue for a damaged or dysfunctional sensibility. Many instances of cruelty to animals fall under this head. But what we can't easily do is bracket all this as turning another person into an object. The surgeon's learned detachment involves a very serious respect for the patient's needs. And the Ugandan militia commander's barbarity likewise involves a wholly realistic awareness of how deep the human damage is going to be, because she knows how and why children matter to mothers. As if that weren't complicated enough, think of a further set of cases. People sometimes report a desire, and sometimes act on it, to end someone else's suffering by killing them because they are themselves so deeply affected by it that it becomes unbearable, whether or not it's actually unbearable for the sufferer. Where do we place this on an empathy-based map? Or think of the figure of the Grand Inquisitor in Dostoevsky's Brothers Karamazov. The Inquisitor polices the religious world and burns heretics because he is profoundly concerned for the well-being of ordinary, vulnerable people who need clear teaching and strong leaders. When he finds that he's inadvertently arrested Jesus Christ, he is eloquently unrepentant. Jesus made things too difficult for human beings and causes them suffering by failing to tell them what makes them happy. Like many another totalitarian, he's motivated by something like compassion. But is this empathy or not in a Baron Cohen world? It certainly involves distress about the suffering of others, even a clear decision to sacrifice one's own comfort for the well-being of others. We're dealing here with someone who claims to know the true significance of another's suffering, almost to feel it more than they do, and certainly, as the Inquisitor insists, to pay over their own peace and good conscience in order to spare others what they're not able to bear. Baron Cohen concludes his book with the bold assertion, I quote, that empathy cannot, by definition, oppress anyone. But this smuggles into the idea of empathy itself, a hidden notion of proper emotional response and the proper handling of it. We may think the Inquisitor deluded or self-deluded, and Dostoevsky, I think, meant him to be entirely sincere and morally plausible. But his problem is not that he's unable to weep for the sufferings of others, and he evidently doesn't get emotional satisfaction from executing people. And on the horizon of this discussion is a related cluster of questions about whether some naturally feel their sufferings more than others. Joanna Burke's learned and provocative book, What It Means to Be Human, offers plenty of instances of pseudoscientific arguments well into the 20th century that what looks like a human being may still not feel or think as we do. We being, of course, white, male, propertied, and so on. Entire cultures worked, and many still work, with anti-empathic habits and principles. Once again, we're up against learned behavior and culturally endorsed behavior. And the idea of empathy erosion as a malfunction within a person's brain can't be all we need to make sense of this sort of history. These aren't questions that just belong to the extreme areas of moral reflection. If it were true that any problem immersed in empathy becomes soluble, it would be true that heightened empathic awareness helped you to choose between not good and evil, but competing goods. Baron Cohen movingly cites the example of bereaved Israeli and Palestinian fathers, each of whom has lost a son to the violence of the other's faction, discovering that their shared experience becomes a ground for deep solidarity. There are, miraculously, many such encounters, and the Bereaved Families Forum in Israel-Palestine is one of the few signs of a humane future in that region. We may well celebrate this and see that a genuine learning about the terrible commonality of suffering must be part of any process of peace building. But the fact of emotional recognition or even identification, this person's suffering is so close to mine that I can't imagine being at odds with them, doesn't in itself prescribe anything like the details of a just resolution. It may and does intensify the felt need for resolution, but that's not quite the same as rendering a situation soluble. The bereaved fathers become advocates for an end to slaughter, and their advocacy is all the more powerful because it comes from an experience of profound cost. Yet it can't in itself determine international boundaries, the rightness or possibility of dismantling West Bank settlements, the return of Palestinian refugees, or the status of Jerusalem. Each issue involves the most serious ethical as well as strategic concerns, yet the empathic resonance of individuals on both sides will not clarify those. And for some outside the immediate situation, deeper awareness of the emotional reality on both sides of a conflict is initially, at least, a deeply confusing thing which makes solutions seem further away than ever. Selective empathy is a great deal easier. I have a vivid memory of the day during a pilgrimage to the Holy Land some 14 years ago, where the pilgrimage group of which I was part had, in the same day, visited a Palestinian village devastated at the time of the Israeli takeover and the Yad Vashem Holocaust Memorial Museum. Deep confusion. Where does empathy belong and what does it resolve? Or more prosaically, two charities are campaigning for funds to alleviate poverty in the developing world. One presents a picture of a single child in its advertising and says simply that a donation of such and such a sum will save that child's life. The other offers a resource pack explaining its strategy in creating small agricultural businesses, or outlining the impact of women's education in raising nutritional levels and life expectancy in a region of Tanzania or Peru. What is an empathic response? One approach assumes that the most effective strategy for fundraising is to appeal to emotional identification, what I called empathic resonance, in such a way that the relief of this child's suffering becomes emotionally attractive. The other assumes that dealing with the cognitive questions about what causes suffering is where a response should begin. Which charity should I support? As chair of Christian Aid, I have views on this, but I'll bracket those. A common enough dilemma in our societies, and one that appeal to empathy will not solve, or may solve in a perilously one-sided way. As Paul Bloom pointed out in a thoughtful and important New Yorker essay of 2013, the identifiable victim effect means that more energy will always be directed towards those needs which have a face attached, so that strategic or structural questions may be sidelined. And by putting pressure on our emotions, making us feel intensely uncomfortable, and suggesting a rapid way of removing that discomfort, the issue may become less one of what an ethical response might be than one of how I make myself feel better, how I deal with my immediate distress at the distress of an identifiable other. Now, this is most definitely not to say that the single child campaign is somehow wrong or misplaced, only that we need to learn caution about presuming that this naked appeal to empathy is the sole governing model for raising ethical awareness. We need only think of cases where there may be competing identifiable victims, and I have in mind not just the way this can be played out, say, in the Israel-Palestine conflict, but the regular standoff in debates about penal policy. You can reasonably invite empathic resonance with the victims of a crime and with the disturbed or deprived individual who's committed it and is now suffering inhumane treatment in a custodial institution. How do you move from there to what a just custodial policy would look like. Locating this against a wider horizon, one of the problems in the background, as I've mentioned briefly, is that an ethical discourse which gives central place to empathy as emotional identification draws our attention away from questions of culture and power. Ethics isn't just about single acts of evil or virtue. Evil is not overcome merely by identifying and correcting the dysfunction of individual brains. It's inseparably bound in to what is made possible or impossible by structures of habit, belief, and advantage. Baron Cohen's summary of the various factors which may serve to justify or rationalize or normalize the inhibition of empathy is helpful here. But we need to see this as not only about the things which may push certain people with genetic or neurological conditions over the edge into extreme behavior, but rather as a sketch of the elements which mold an entire social world of moral possibilities and which determine various kinds of suffering demanding an ethical response. These are the forces that shape what we take for granted in a society. Who is eligible as candidate for empathic feelings or behavior? Who decides who is eligible? How competing claims for empathic response are evaluated, and so on. So that, as I've said, empathic erosion can't serve as a substitute for the whole story of what we call evil, even if we were able to tidy up the very diverse senses at work here of empathy as a concept. And even if we were to grant that empathy failures, in the sense of grossly insensitive acts, were among the most visible signs of malfunction and inequity of power in a society. So how might we begin to tidy up the concept? Bracketing for a moment the prehistory of some of these issues in discussions from Adam Smith onwards of sympathy, the question of how to define empathy surfaces first in the context of a phenomenological reflection on our knowledge of the intentions of others. Edmund Husserl's pupil, Edith Stein, later to become a Carmelite nun and to die in Auschwitz, wrote a doctoral dissertation on Einfühlung in 1916, attempting to chart what was then a notable bit of unfinished business in the program of phenomenology. Husserl had touched on the question of what was involved in recognizing another body as a subject of sensation, and thus a partner in communication. But it was Stein who followed through the implications of this to argue that the individual ego could not constitute itself for thought without the awareness of the possibility of perceptions from other centers, that is, without the givenness of other embodied minds. In a very compressed and difficult text, Stein connects the sense of my own body as what she calls a zero point of orientation, with the awareness of other bodies as alive in the way that my body is alive. What she calls reiterated empathy or reflexive sympathy, the capacity not only to comprehend the experience of another subject, but to comprehend that and to some extent how the other subject comprehends me, entail that my sense of myself is always going to be capable of correction or supplement from the perspective of the other. To apprehend another body is to apprehend another standpoint. I know without learning it that another body, like mine, is incapable of being comprehensively viewed from its own standpoint. One of the things about bodies is that you can't see your back, not to mention the fact that you can't see your eyes. The very idea of a consistent spatial world is bound up with the awareness of diverse zero points of orientation. To conceive of an object is to conceive of a set of perceptions irreducible to each other. Try to think of an object world without this dimension, and you'll be imprisoned in what Stein calls primordial sensation, and incapable of forming any concept whatsoever or any strategy for dealing consistently with the material world. To think objects is to think perceiving others. My own self-awareness becomes properly itself, therefore, only when open to the exchanges and supplements of other conscious bodies, in the construction of a physical world, but also, and even more importantly, in the construction of a self-questioning and thus developing or maturing consciousness. So the world I perceive is perceived recursively, not only in the apparent simplicity of the primordial sensation. I see it through the eyes of another, and another, and another. I construct fresh perspectives, imagined positions of presence, not unlike the imagined presence that's evoked when I remember a past sensation. But there are two particular further points specially germane to our discussion. The first is Stein's distinction, drawn at the very beginning of her dissertation, between being, as she puts it, in the experience of another and being at the point of the experience of another. What's significant is not the perceiving state of mind of the other, its mental content, but the perceived object apprehended by me in a sort of secondary primordiality, as she calls it, which in turn feeds in to the developed and developing sense of a world or an object or another self. The second point is her insistence that at no stage am I drawing conclusions or inferences from a set of physical sensations to a hidden interiority, going through the process of deducing that there must be an inside to the other body, a subjective state, because my body has an inside. I have ideas. No, she says, recognizing a body, not just a lump of stuff, recognizing a body is recognizing a conscious stance, or indeed a pre-conscious one, a bare capacity to be a zero point of orientation. Recognizing a body is recognizing what is always a meaning-bearing system. And she puts it very provocatively when she says, we can imagine an ego without a body, but not a body without an ego. Bodies are not something we start by thinking of as lumps of stuff and subsequently conclude to be sentient or intelligent. And if that's the case, our primordial apprehension of the world is always bound up with the secondary primordiality, sorry about the jargon, that is the awareness of other perspectives. To grow into the very concept of a world is a matter of empathy, as defined here. Einfühlung, feeling our way into the resistant and difficult perspective that is not ours, as an essential aspect of conceiving objects, conceiving what we call an agenda set for us by something other than our primordial individual awareness of being a center of experience. And as she argues rather sketchily at the end of the dissertation, if the other's body is a sight for perceiving, S-I-T-E, that is, sight for perceiving, it's also the sight of a continuous narrative of some kind, or, to use her preferred vocabulary, an intelligible unity enacted by a subject. Now, this discussion is obviously cast in radically different terms from the contemporary treatments of empathy. Stein isn't primarily interested in feelings here, but it does have some essential things to contribute to it. Stein's Einfühlung is not a simple matter of identification with another's emotions. It could better be described as the capacity to apprehend the environment from a perspective that isn't our own, resulting in two sorts of knowing: an enhanced awareness of that environment, and in an indirect sense of some of what it might be like to experience the environment from that standpoint. The terminus is not the other's state of mind as such, but what that state of mind represents to itself. Learning occurs precisely through the irreducible tension between my primordial sensation and the displaced awareness of self and world seen from and imagined elsewhere. And out of this comes a constantly expanding capacity to map the depth of the perceptual world I inhabit and the honesty and adequacy of the spiritual and moral world. That is, of what I say to myself about myself in the hope of making sense of my own narrative beyond a mere succession of happenings. So this is a multi-layered understanding of empathy, which resolutely doesn't focus on the appropriation of another's emotion. It's inseparably connected with a recognition of being located in relation to an indefinite set of fluid, possible perspectives which can be imaginatively approached, though not decisively inhabited or colonized. The world presented to my primary apprehension is made increasingly diverse, capable of being unsettled all the time by the awareness of a newly strange perspective. And if so, my awareness of the emotion of another is neither a simple cognitive registering of the fact that a recognizable feeling is going on, nor a direct quasi-primordial share in the feeling as if it were mine. Awareness of the emotion of another is one aspect of recognizing the meaning embodied in another's face or gesture. That is, recognizing that what is in front of me is not a passive object, but a center of communicative activity. Something in important respects beyond my grasp, yet something I have to factor in as a source of significance, perhaps of significant puzzlement, in making sense of myself in the environment that I and the other share. So empathic understanding in this framework is not so much something that breaks down some barrier between self and other, as something that insists on the self's position as potential object to other subjects, on the self's identity as holding one perspective among many, and thus on the self's need to inquire what it must receive from the experience of another in order to go on being itself, coherently and sustainably, in an intelligible environment. On this sort of analysis, to lack empathy would be less a matter of failing to sense or own the emotional state of another than failing to sense the necessary incompleteness of any sense of the emotional state of another. It would also be to have a faulty apprehension of what was involved in thinking of a shared world, a world in which every perspective is physically incapable of viewing itself fully and therefore has to collaborate in some sense with other subjects. Now, none of this means that the neuroscientific perspective with which we began is being wrongly or irrelevantly interpreted. It's simply to argue that we need a rather more resourceful conceptual pattern in which to locate it. If empathy is understood primarily as appropriate emotional ownership of another's sensations, especially of pain, I would say we risk a kind of derealizing of the actual complexity of anyone's emotional life. It can come dangerously close to claiming to absorb another emotional history into my own. It raises the acute question mentioned earlier of the politics of emotion and the cultural definitions of who is or what is eligible for fellow feeling. And it leaves us with no help in those ethical situations where, for whatever reason, we can't easily find ways of emotional identification. James Mumford, in his important and provocative study of ethics at the beginning of life, in which he critically discusses Stein on empathy, notes that if empathy is linked with someone else's capacity to present herself as a fully fledged, mature thou to me, and if that's the condition for empathy, then we have difficulty in explaining just why we might feel or exercise empathy with a newborn child, let alone an unborn child. And he writes, to base who's in and who's out upon empathy ignores the way human being appears in the world. From Mumford's point of view, recognition is going to be an inadequate basis for ethical duty, as it seems to require the other to produce credentials. And if empathy and recognition belong together, we have a problem. His discussion, as I've argued at slightly more length in the fuller version of this text, his discussion gives a bracing, necessary challenge to well-meaning but ultimately misdirected appeals to one kind of empathy, though I think he's slightly unfair to Stein. But what her treatment in fact points to is the importance of approaching the question of empathy with an eye to two dimensions which have been obscured by some of the recent popular treatments I've alluded to. if the significant aspect of empathy is recognizing an irreducible zero point outside my own consciousness, an embodied other, this means that empathic recognition is, paradoxically, the recognition of something radically inaccessible. Something, that is, which will never be assimilable, because while I may be, in Stein's phrase, at the point of another's experience imaginatively, I can't actually be in it, in a material world. It's possible for me to grasp in some measure the content of what the other perceives, but that grasp is always of a view I do not inhabit, a view I can move away from in a way that I can't move away from my own embodiedness. I can imagine what it's like for you to look long-sufferingly at a lecturer from where you sit, and then I can move away with relief from the terrible prospect that opens up for me and return here. What I can't do is abandon my perspective on the audience. I am an embodied perspective. And Stein is very clear that it's of the essence of bodily existence that I don't have the option of withdrawing definitively from the perspective it establishes. So if we were to speak here of erosion of empathy, it would be more than a failure to appreciate the intensity of another's experience. As I hinted a few minutes ago, it could just as easily be the over-eager appropriation of another's experience and the denial of its difference and its contingency. Following on from this, Stein wants empathic understanding to be corrigible. She conceives Einfühlung as something always to be learned. Empathy is bound up for her with that reciprocal, or as I put it, recursive sympathy, which constantly allows me to apprehend some of what the other sees of myself, and thus impresses on me the fallibility of my individual intuition and the inescapable role of taking time in understanding myself and others. There is no shortcut into the alien heart of the neighbor, any more than into the obscure territory that is my own embodied selfhood. It's summed up at the end of Stein's dissertation in a couple of very significant phrases. I quote, "By empathy with differently composed personal structures, we become clear on what we are not, what we are more or less than others. Our own unfamiliar values become visible. When we empathically run into ranges of value closed to us, we become conscious of our own deficiency or disvalue. The empathic position is one in which we know that we are not the other, and also know in this moment that we have to go on learning and relearning who we are and what we actually care about by means of attention to the alien perspective we are piecing together, imagining or intuiting. Empathy in this sense is not a matter of opening up myself to receive the emotional matter of another life, but of acquiring a critical capacity in respect of my own sensing and feeling, especially in respect of my self-awareness. The ethically significant expression of this sort of empathy would be in saying not, I know how you feel, but I have no idea how you feel. In standing before the other with a very particular kind of care, close to what Simone Weil calls hesitation, acknowledging that I have no alternative but to learn the otherness of the other. So in this lecture overall, my main concern has been to problematize a particular current rhetoric about empathy, which seems to assume that the issues around inhuman and abusive behavior are best addressed by appeals to empathy understood as the capacity to recognize and respond appropriately to the suffering of another subject. This, I've argued, will take us only so far. It sidelines issues around the cultural dimension of the question and leaves us with some ambiguities about recognition and the risks of over-appropriating the experience of another. Edith Stein's account of the question, coming as it does from a radically different perspective, offers some resource, I believe, for a more nuanced approach, one which, in fact, does more justice to the very important fact noted by Sue Gerhardt in the book I quoted at the start of these remarks, that the area of the brain associated with empathy, in the most general sense of intelligent apprehension of another's state of feeling, is also associated with mind reading, irony, faux pas, reading others' affects, realizing deception. In other words, the empathic response is connected to a range of mental skills that deal with gaps between appearances and truth, between first and subsequent impressions or readings of our environment. In the light of our discussion of Stein, we could say that the empathic stance is inseparable from a capacity to suspend attachment to what Stein would call the primordial, to refuse to leave it and the primordially sensing subject invulnerable to scrutiny. Before I close, just one or two further observations, one about what I'm leaving out and one about what I'm hoping to tackle tomorrow. First of all, to develop an ethical stance conditioned by this way of defining empathy involves, I've said, a strong affirmation of the importance of what we don't know about the other, and a clear imperative against any colonization of the experience of the other, which would render it easier to assimilate. And when I speak of the move to seeing the self as stranger, which is something running through tomorrow's discussion, it's that, of course, the understanding of the strangeness and inaccessibility of the other's perspective opens up dimensions of the inaccessibility of myself to myself. More of that anon. And I'll be looking tomorrow at some of what that entails with a bit of help from Stanley Cavell and Gillian Rose, exploring how the empathic stance does and does not work in thinking about politics as well as personal relations more narrowly conceived. But one thing which I think is quite significant in the margin of this is a couple of theological considerations which, to me as a theologian, bear on some of this fairly directly. One is to do with the complicated idea developed by the Anglican poet and critic Charles Williams of what he called co-inherence, the sense that it is in some sense possible within the community of faith literally to carry the suffering of another on their behalf. It's something a little bit more radical than empathy, as we've discussed it. It's something which I think doesn't entirely run against some of Stein's perspectives, but is not without its ambivalence. I mention this simply as a marginal subject, which I find pertinent to some of these matters, but I'll put it on one side for the moment. Perhaps slightly more directly is the much controverted issue of whether we can talk about God's literal, direct solidarity with human suffering, a theme very popular in much contemporary theology, but raising for me some very, very searching questions about whether speaking in these terms doesn't have the same effect I touched on earlier of derealizing the other's suffering. God is in solidarity with all human suffering. God suffers everyone's suffering. But doesn't that detach suffering from the personal history in which it occurs and which makes it the kind of suffering it is? Isn't it a generalizing, a homogenizing of human suffering, which again carries a difficult moral charge? Suffering is diverse. It is the suffering it is because the person is the person they are. A burned finger is for the concert pianist a different matter from what it would be for a university lecturer. A traffic delay is one thing for a professional on their way to work, another for a woman about to give birth, or an ambulance driver with a patient in the back bleeding uncontrollably. Suffering is context-specific and person-specific, and the compassionate other may feel acutely but does not and cannot feel identically as the other does. To claim otherwise is either to generalize the notion of suffering intolerably or to remove from the suffering in question precisely what makes it the suffering it is for the person involved. And that's where I think some of the language that is rather loosely used about God's solidarity with human suffering, needs a bit of critical puncturing, and at least some of Simone Weil-style hesitation. Tomorrow, as I say, I'll want to look at some of the ways in which these themes are developed in the work of your local hero, Stanley Cavell, and the British Hegelian philosopher, Gillian Rose. I hope to show that in the light of today's discussion, it's possible to develop a notion of an empathic stance, which takes utterly seriously the need to recognize the irreducible and inaccessible otherness of the other, and in that sense also the otherness of the self to the self. And I hope that at least some of you may have the patience to come back and engage with part two of these reflections, and I'm very grateful for your patience this afternoon. Thank you.
David Tracy will now make his remarks and reflections on the talk. Thank you, David.
Thank you. President Gilpin Faust, my good friend, Professor Homi Bhabha, and your grace, Dr. Williams. It's a delight to be here to respond briefly to Dr. Williams' comments. In his rich and complex lecture, which we have just heard in a longer version I was able to read, Dr. Williams has manifested once again his exceptional ability to develop his own position here on the much-discussed issue of empathy. In direct dialogue, as is his character, with other discussions of empathy, which has become indeed a major topic in neuroscience, in philosophy and theology and other disciplines. He might have added, for example, the debates in law schools on the presence or absence of empathy for judges, as my colleagues in law school tell me, as well as in theater departments on the role of empathy or its absence for actors, since the method. In medical schools and schools of psychiatry, in empathy's role for nurses and doctors, for indeed psychiatrists and all therapists, and in any school of ministry where the very nature and many roles of empathy for the minister is necessarily of great interest. And even, I've been reading World War I histories for late night reading, as many are this centenary, the last 2 months, and even in some histories, some of which, with a horror like that war, are empathic and others not, and it's interesting to decide why a scholar so decides. An example, as you all well know, is a now classical study, empathic historical study, called, as the title alone suggests, The Republic of Suffering by President Faust. Now, in order to study empathy in any genuinely interdisciplinary way, Dr. Williams, a distinguished philosophical theologian, turns, interestingly enough, first neither to philosophy nor theology, which have, in fact, a lot to say on it, but to neuroscience, very well, I think, for its scientific ability to assign feeling states to distinctly defined regions of the brain. Intriguingly, empathy is located in the same brain region, as Dr. Gerhardt mentions, as he said, I was fascinated, as the production of irony, and of other mental functions designed to distinguish truth from appearance. A philosopher's topic. In his first section, Dr. Williams focuses principally on the renowned neuroscientific work on empathy of Dr. Baron Cohen, his colleague at Cambridge. And Dr. Baron Cohen has addressed empathy in several works, in fact, especially, of the two I read, especially in his more publicly available work for the rest of us called 0 Degrees of Empathy. In that most interesting work, Dr. Baron Cohen summarizes for a wider public his years of empirical neuroscientific studies of empathy that followed upon his famous studies of autism. Now, Dr. Williams is characteristically both generous and judicious in his assessment of Baron Cohen's project on empathy. On the one hand, Dr. Williams is surely correct to call his fellow scholars in all the humanities, including philosophy and theology, to begin to study neuroscience more carefully, to begin to study the range and import of work like Dr. Baron Cohen's neuroscientific analyses of empathy. They're fascinating and important. On the other hand, Dr. Williams is surely also just as correct in his quiet but effective criticism of some of Baron Cohen's overclaims, as I would call them. For example, I found, perhaps less generously than Dr. Williams, some of Baron Cohen's suggestions somewhat bizarre, such as his claim that his studies are not merely a very important scientific resource for all of us, as indeed they are, but that his neuroscientific analysis of empathy can now replace all earlier studies on evil and suffering. Now, Dr. Baron Cohen even holds, in one of his comments that threw me a bit, that the concept evil, a traditional category after all in religion, as he says, in philosophy, in literature, isn't Dostoevsky, all sorts of literature, or for that matter, in everyday life, is unfortunately evil, a pre-scientific and no longer a useful category for reflection on suffering. I find that odd. Unfortunately, this judgment on the need to replace the traditional discussions of evil and suffering, replace with his own neuroscientific understanding of empathy, does not seem to be burdened, at least in the two books I read, with any extensive study by Dr. Baron Cohen of centuries of philosophical and theological and literary extended and subtle analyses of the related problems of evil and suffering, for in fact the last 2,500 years, nor by the veritable flood of great historical and literary works on the topic. Dr. Williams further suggests that Baron Cohen's definitions of empathy are a bit elusive, even at times, he says in the written text, rather slippery. It seems to me right that Baron Cohen's understanding of empathy needs the kind of conceptual clarification which philosophy can contribute. A neuroscientific notion of empathy, which is extremely valuable for all of us, is in fact somewhat, as Dr. Williams says, ahistorical and too privatized for a wider ethic. It therefore seems to ignore the problems of language, culture, and power, which after all need to be addressed if the important newly analyzed neuroscientific problems of empathy, so valuable, is to find full conceptual clarification and its proper place in a wider, more complex ethics. Now, for the conceptual clarification of empathy, Dr. Williams, I think most interestingly, turns to a critic who has been ignored for many years, even within phenomenology, which I do, namely to the early, strictly eidetic, as it's called in phenomenology, not existential, not hermeneutic, not linguistic, but the early phenomenology, eidetic phenomenology of Edith Stein in 1916, her doctoral dissertation, in fact. The more I read it and reread Stein, which I hadn't read for many years, this seems a very good choice. For Edith Stein's rigorous phenomenological description of empathy as embodied feeling and embodied mind is a classic, in fact, in early phenomenological studies and well deserves retrieval as it has received from Dr. Williams. Stein, after all, followed the early objective eidetic phenomenological method of Edmund Husserl in the early 20th century, when Husserl was developing his method of objective description to intentionality of external objects and internal intentional states and acts. In fact, while she was studying with him, she was his assistant and one of his best students, he always said, he himself was changing from that objective, eidetic, realistic position, in fact, to a transcendental, idealist position, which Stein and the other early eidetics rejected, but many others, like Heidegger and many others, followed. I fully agree with Dr. Williams that the analyses of early eidetic phenomenology, like Edith Stein's on empathy or Max Scheler's on sympathy, should be retrieved today as a valuable conceptual clarification of feelings like empathy or sympathy and many others' feelings. Among her other accomplishments, Edith Stein proposed what was in fact a highly original phenomenological description of the intrinsic role, as you have just heard from Dr. Williams, so I will not repeat it at length, the intrinsic role of one's inescapable body in the feelings of empathy, not just mind, as people have thought before, as well as in the intrinsic necessity for the empathic embodied self, as mind, to sense the reality of the other as other, that is, as another living body, Leib, as distinct from just physical body, Körper, as an alternative view of my own embodied self. It's worth noting that I really liked that he took her up, made me reread her, among others, and maybe others too, is that Stein's early phenomenology of empathy, by the way, in her pre-Christian period, she was not a Christian when she wrote this, is chronologically prior to the more familiar phenomenology of the body by Merleau-Ponty, who I think was influenced clearly by Stein. And even later, the now famous phenomenology of the other by Emmanuel Levinas. Or, in terms of a wider ethic, the phenomenologist and hermeneutician Paul Ricoeur's magnum opus for ethics with the wonderful title, Myself as an Other. In fact, Williams' interpretation of Stein on empathy shows, in fact, I think to everyone's surprise, including some famous phenomenologists I've asked, like my colleague Jean-Luc Marion, that Stein's analysis already includes, this is the amazing thing he's shown us, attention to both one's body, Merleau-Ponty, and the other's body, Levinas and Ricoeur, all of whom are much later, as objectively essential, that is, eidetic elements in any conceptual clarification of the full dimensions of empathy. This choice of Stein for philosophical conceptual clarification in defining empathy, I would also add to what he said and wrote, a good choice for another reason, that unlike her mentor Husserl and most of the other early eidetic phenomenologists, when they worked out their conceptual clarifications of various feelings, they did not wish to relate them, as Dr. Williams so rightly does, to psychological studies and neuroscientific studies. But Edith Stein did. That's another way she was quite unusual. Husserl and the others always denoted any attempt like that as, quote, psychologism, not to be done. Stein mentions the neurological studies of the brain available in the science of her day. Remember, we're talking 1916. In fact, neuroscientific studies of the brain, now so prominent and important in our contemporary intellectual landscape for all of us, were in a very early stage of development in Stein's own period. The brain, infinitely better understood now, although still not fully mapped, was largely, in fact, a terra incognita in Stein's own day. So it is intriguing to speculate, which is all I can do, how Stein might have approached Baron Cohen's wonderful neuroscientific findings. Other phenomenologists would not be too interested, and many other philosophers, I think. But I think Stein would have responded positively, if critically, along the lines of Rowan Williams, given her own early extensive work in psychology and interest in the neurology available. In fact, she studied psychology for some years and was preparing a doctorate in the subject before shifting to a doctorate in philosophy after discovering, as many did at the period, Husserl's early phenomenology. But perhaps the main contribution of Edith Stein's analysis of empathy is its clarification of the primacy of the sheer fact of embodiedness, as was emphasized by Dr. Williams. Both my own body as my non-negotiable point of departure for any attempt at empathic experience, and the embodiedness of the other as always already there, in fact, prior to any more developed notion of the self. Now, my empathy towards other, therefore, is for Edith Stein in no way a claim to appropriate their feelings now as my own. Rather, empathy allows, if I may use the other famous word, of Shaler in this case, a compassionate sympathy with the others, whose very difference forces me to correct not only my earlier views of the other as other, but just as importantly, to keep me correcting my own understanding of my own self through the other's perspective on me. Empathy is a two-edged sword. For example, any claim by someone in a dominant culture, let us say a culture with colonies, to the claim to empathize with a colonized subject is, as post-colonial theory has so sharply shown us all, to be held under suspicion. Empathy can be too easily used. If the colonizer's empathy were genuine empathy in Stein's sense, which is in fact highly unlikely, given the destructive power relationships inevitably involved, it would result not in any claim to feel the colonized pain, which is deeply insulting, beyond patronizing. Rather, given the imperialist power structure pervading and inevitably poisoning any notion of equality to allow empathy here, renders the question much more complex. One would have to deal, as Dr. Williams insists, and will in his next lecture also, with power relationships in order to understand empathy in a non-ahistorical way. Despite Baron Cohen's great contributions, it is finally ahistorical. Professor Homi Bhabha, for example, in his famous post-colonial theory of hybridity, exposes, I think, what Professor Rowan Williams, in his implicitly post-colonialist reading of the need to address power issues in the phenomenon of empathy, which otherwise it can be all too easy, all too private, all too ahistorical, shows so well the fact that any correct conceptual clarification of empathy must also move into issues of language, as later phenomenologists do, Heidegger, Gadamer, Ricoeur, etc., and culture and power. Any authentic empathy always demands that it is always corrigible. As I learn more and more about the other as other and not a projection of my present desires and needs, but who also provides me with a different perspective on my own otherness, myself as an other, as Ricoeur insists. Empathy should include an ability to understand such realities of power relationships inevitably involved in our interrelationships, however empathic. By empathically reaching out to the other, the self learns something about the other and about itself, namely, how the self is itself partly constituted by the perspectives of others. This is where I think Stein is in advance on Levinas, who has an absolutely exclusive interest in the other, but not in what the other might do about the self. In empathy, as generically any human attempt to sympathize with the suffering of others, I begin to feel, as Dr. Williams showed so well, I think, my own ignorance of the other. And one could add of oneself, which ignorance is itself a form of pain and suffering. My only suggestion for Dr. Williams here is that in order to further develop what I think is his excellent interpretation of the complexities involved in this seemingly obvious phenomenon of empathy, especially once you take advantage of the splendid neuroscientific studies of figures like Dr. Baron Cohen, but also pay attention to language, culture, and power. He might turn as well to contemporary critical theories, which he knows quite well. Gillian Rose is one. To study the power relationships embedded in all forms of empathy. As critical as distinct from traditional theory, critical theory after all, what is different about it, it's explicitly designed to suspect, the hermeneutics of suspicion, as they now say, and to expose, and as much as possible, to help heal. The original model in the Frankfurt School and others was always Freud's psychoanalytic model. Not so much our conscious errors, which one can do through good argument and appealing to scientific evidence, but not our conscious errors, but our usually unconscious, but in fact structurally systemic distortions that are involved in experience as empathy. Let me remind you of the now very familiar list of the kinds of issues that have been developed by various, very fruitful in my judgment, critical theories, which could be very fruitful on empathy too, to heighten the understanding of the realities involved of sexism, racism, classism, homophobia, elitism, colonialism, anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, and all the other poisonous and finally perverse isms that we now admit afflict us in a thousand forms, including all our expressions of empathy. Empathy is, as Dr. Williams argues, an ethical attempt to understand and feel with, nice expression, have hesitation towards, feel with, not to claim to feel into the other, in spite of the original Greek. Empatheia, as this thing from sympatheia. The other are different. When understood in the fuller sense, as Dr. Williams' work is doing, of the historical, linguistic, culture, and power of inflected actuality structuring expressions of empathy, which I repeat, critical theories, I think, there are so many of them and they're so valuable, can helpfully expose. Empathy can be one of the major factors, once redone in William's way, for an ethical step forward toward an ethics where difference and otherness is always not only affirmed, but analyzed carefully in the full range of the that he is involved with, from neuroscience to conceptual clarification to culture, language, and power. Otherwise, empathy too, like every other phenomenon, where difference is claimed but in fact reduced, could just be one more example in Michel Foucault's fine phrase of all being reduced, all difference being reduced to just more of the same. From his other writing, it is clear that Rowan Williams is not only, as he is in my judgment, our most erudite and pluralistic Christian theologian today, but that he has also served as a major public intellectual in Great Britain and internationally, here, for example. Hence, I presume to suggest, by the suggestion of critical theory, merely some more arrows for his multi-splendored bow. The use of explicitly critical theories, like post-colonial theory and the others I've mentioned, in order more deeply to historicize what he's already employed, Edith Stein's eidetic phenomenology of empathy, with the later developments in phenomenology, hermeneutics, and critical theory itself, which Stein was murdered and did not live to see, murdered at Auschwitz. A final note. It is intriguing in his brief, explicitly theological reflections on contemporary theological debates on divine impassibility or solidarity, with, if it should be rethought. I think more than he does that it should, but it's another issue. Dr. Williams shifts from the language of empathy quietly to the language of compassion. Compassion, like sympathy, sympatheia, more clearly avoids, I think, any possible misunderstandings, and I agree with him, there are many, of what the claim is on the nature of God's love as solidarity with suffering of all. So in full agreement with Rowan Williams' splendid lecture and his reminder that we should not falsely claim to an understanding of another's pain, an understanding we do not in fact possess. I feel your pain is finally a rather silly statement, despite its fame in this country from a former president, whom I voted for. It is said, Edith Stein wisely insisted that empathy is the important phenomenon it is, and she analyzed it so well, but that ultimately all of us concerned and interested in empathy should realize that what it provides is, quote, surface lights over an incomprehensible abyss. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. Thank you, Dr. David Tracy. One question, and I would like to open up. There was a line in the talk where you said there are no shortcuts into the alien heart of the neighbor. And there is a kind of resonance of Levinas there. There's a notion of temporal difference and temporal distance. And I'd like you to, both of you, just to think about how one moves from you know, what you so well described is the asymmetry that you need to have, that you absolutely need to have with the other. The other cannot, is not open to you, and if it were indeed open to you, indeed if the other were at a level of equality, then the whole ethical ethical struggle, the agonism would, yes, would not exist. Yeah. So how then do we think of the neighbor outside of just the purely phenomenological metaphor of the neighbor, in terms of solidarity, in terms of civic, the civic relation, which I know you both are very interested in. I think sometimes too often the metaphor of the neighbor, or the neighbor as a kind of metaphoric or metonymic figure in phenomenology, doesn't allow you to ask this question about the construction of neighborhoods to put it in a banal way. And yet I think it has a very important role to play, particularly now where you get neighborhoods and neighbors of people who are really, where there is a felt incommensurability. Whether that incommensurability is true, there is a felt antagonism or alienation. There is a really felt lack of knowing who I am in relation to who she is. And that sometimes can go badly wrong. That particular affect, that particular basis on which the philosophical case for for empathy is made. It can turn the other way. Mm.
That's a hugely interesting and important dimension, I think. And I guess that is not unconnected with Gillian Rose's concern to move us on to thinking about law in the most constructive and benign sense of that word. In other words, law becomes the way in which we construct public space, not on the basis of identical interest or fellow feeling, but on the basis of a really rather austere recognition that public space is the space where the liberty of the other to speak is guaranteed. And I think that perhaps is near the bottom line, the liberty of the other to speak, and the liberty of the subaltern to speak, and the liberty of the stranger, the metic, to speak. When we don't know what they're going to say, but act with a kind of systematic trust that what is sayable by the stranger is hearable, and that something unfolds from that fact once we have granted. Who's we here? Well, let it stand for a moment, but once there has been granted.
Oh, no, don't put it that way. Stick with the we.
Stay with the we. Once there is a liberty to speak, the law enshrines. That's one way to it.
I just actually wanted to bring the law in.
Absolutely.
Here. Otherwise, the machine can keep moving.
And this is where Gillian Rose's discussion, especially in her posthumous collection of essays, Morning Becomes the Law, wants to wean us away from sentimental solidarities to civic solidarities, which I think is not a bad direction
Thank
to
you.
Go.
I just wanted you to clarify. I wanted you to clarify that, David.
Well, I again agree, but it might be worth adding that I quite agree with you, Homi, that the word neighbor has become a rather sentimental category, which I think is why many have started using stranger, right? Hospitality to the stranger, like Derrida does. Very nice work on that, I think. But neighbor should not be a sentimental concept. It's actually a quite radical concept, as Nietzsche, who didn't like it, saw very clearly. It is what transvalues all the values that the culture had. No Greek would talk. For Nietzsche, he's right. Aristotle would think it nonsense to say you should have love for the neighbor. The best you could do was a friend, family, maybe a country or a polis. But a neighbor, anyone, the near one, that's the radicality of someone like Levinas. I think he's recaptured the radicality of what neighbor means. And in that sense, and before him, in terms of against it, Nietzsche captured it. he thought it was absurd. Freud also thought it was absurd, you know, in that neighbor love. He thought it was impossible. So that I rather like emphasizing neighbor as long as you rightly say, you remove what is too, it can easily become a kind of Hallmark card, but it isn't. It's actually one of the most interesting biblical innovations, Jewish, Christian, and Islamic, into Western culture and through that in other cultures.
Yeah, there's a wonderful line by Levinas. The neighbor is always late for the meeting, you know. Yes. Of course, people like me who come from India and always late for every appointment, then make a plea for my own understanding for hospitality on the basis of this idea that, but the idea that you're not going to get that symmetry. There's always going to be that.
And as David says, the notion that there is an ethic of sheer proximity is what is radical here.
It is radical.
And the fact that, again, thinking of some early Christian writers, one text I often quote reflecting on this is something that Clement of Alexandria writes about the extraordinariness of a love in the Christian context, which is, he says, akinonos. It's nothing to do with commonality as we instinctively understand it. It is just about radical difference affirmed.
Yes.
And what neighborliness in this sense captures, I think, or what I call sheer proximity just now, is also, to come back to what you mentioned in your introduction, Homi, the contingency of the claim upon us. Mm-hmm. We do not, isn't this part of the point of the Good Samaritan parable? We precisely do not answer in advance the question, who is my neighbor?
Yes.
Because that is of its nature, utterly contingent.
Thank you very much for those responses. I just want to put that on the table. Let's open up to questions. There is somebody right there, yes. If you would just introduce yourself, say.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Spelke. Thank you, Dr. Williams, for a beautiful lecture. I am very interested that you're going to be talking tomorrow about self-knowledge, and perhaps I should be saving this question for then, but I wanted to say something now about something that I think we learn from the fields of human cognitive psychology and cognitive neuroscience that are the fields of Simon Baron Cohen, whose work you talked about, that I think could be, I'd be interested to hear what you think about their potential relevance to ethical projects. I think we learn three things in general about human experience from these fields. The first thing that we learn is that the world that we experience directly, our feelings, our thoughts, our intuitions, are the tip of a vast iceberg. And underneath them are an enormous set of processes that we don't have any conscious access to, but that are real, and whose workings account for everything that we perceive and judge and feel and express to other people when we communicate with them, that there's a huge world there. The second thing I think we learn is that we can learn something about that world, and in doing so, about our experience of the world through the kind of collective, collaborative enterprise that scientists engage in, working together, sharing findings, doing experiments, attempting to reduce our ignorance about these vast sources of our experience of the world. And the third thing that I think we learn from cognitive neuroscience is that we're at the beginning of a very long road in understanding ourselves, that there's been real progress in understanding, for example, how perception works or where some abstract ideas might come from. But the amount of progress is minuscule compared to the number of outstanding questions, and I mean simply outstanding questions of fact before we even get to questions of value. And in light of things that you said today, I thought that these might actually be interesting lessons. I'm curious to know what you think from cognitive neuroscience. They suggest a kind of humility, not only in our sense of what we can understand about others, but in our sense of what we understand about ourselves and our own experience and what it comes from. And also maybe a sense of optimism about another collective project. not only collective projects in fields like the humanities and the social sciences, but also in the sciences that can help us to better understand ourselves and others.
Thank you.
Thank you. Shall I respond? Thank you very much indeed for that. What came to mind as I listened to you was a memory of visiting the Sanger Institute near Cambridge a couple of years ago to hear a bit about the progress of the Human Genome Project at the time. And an enormous wall covered with charts of genetic code material marked in different colors. You know, these are the bits where we understand how the code more or less works. These are the bits where we've got a pretty good idea. And the yards and yards and yards of what's left is where we haven't got a clue, where we can specify the content but not the operation. So certainly at the beginning of a long road is an obvious thing about that. And one of the excitements about some of these areas of science, whether it's genetics or neurobiology, is the feeling that, yes, there are new perspectives constantly coming up which make connections of a kind we hadn't expected. For me, as David, I think, would agree, the association in the neurobiological picture between empathy and irony is a rather unexpected and suggestive one, isn't it? As you spoke, I began to think we ought to have a song like Ebony and Ivory, you know, Empathy and Irony, which would have lots of things to suggest to us. That's the kind of fresh insight which I think carries across from the sciences to the humanities, in fact. And what you say about the collaborative nature of the project is, again, to me, one of the most interesting things about the scientific enterprise. It's odd sometimes that you get the occasional scientist who, in their publication of research, will stress very heavily almost the kind of individual functional unit of the self, the brain, while the method that they employ is intensely collaborative, conversational, and cumulative. The last point in response is the tip of the iceberg stuff. And here, I think we tread with some caution, as appropriately, on ice, even thick ice, like icebergs. I think what I feel about that is that, yes, we're at the beginning of a long and immensely suggestive process of discovery, and that we need to be a trifle cautious about the category of question we're asking. So that, for example, the kind of popular semi-science, semi-philosophy book which says, well, you know, we're on the way to explaining consciousness, that's when I want to bang my head against a wall and say, no, that is an ill-formed question. Consciousness is not a thing that we identify. Precisely because of the recursive character of consciousness, we are consciously posing the question of what kind of thing consciousness is, and that ought to make us philosophically unhappy, put it that way. So, along with people like Raymond Tallis, and to some extent David Chalmers's wonderful work on consciousness, I would say, let's be clear what kind of question this is and isn't, and not expect neuroscience to deliver answers to badly formed questions. I should say that, of course, Tallis and Chalmers, who don't entirely agree with each other, have no theological axe to grind on this. They really are insisting on the grammar of how we talk consciousness here. Thank you.
No. Yes, there are 1, 2, and 3 questions. You could start with the lady in the blue jumper here. White shirt and black top.
Okay. Hi, I loved your lecture, by the way, and also David's commentary. I was just wondering, to what extent did Edward Said, if at all, shape your work? Because it occurred to me that you were using one of his terms that he has brought to the fore back in 1970 with his book on Orientalism. And I was just wondering the extent to which he shaped your work.
Interesting question. Not consciously very much, actually, but I think as part of a broad intellectual framework, which I guess I've received as much through people like Jacqueline Rose as anybody, Said's presence is a significant one in my thinking, and that's, I guess, why I want to make sure that issues about power, advantage, and so forth are factored into any discussion we have here, as we've heard more than once. So I'm glad you raised that.
Hi, good afternoon. Thank you so much for your lecture. I guess I had a question. If indeed empathy is instead rather a point of connection with the other than a emphasis of the other's otherness, I'm curious as to why it works as a reciprocal thing, why the person who is being empathized with, the sufferer, if you will, feels then a point of connection with the empathizer that then potentially reduces that person's suffering. It would seem that it's not flowing both ways, and it's not a sort of exactly reciprocal relationship if we go along with this idea of it creating this abyss between us rather than bringing us closer together. And yet when we are the sufferer, precisely what we desire is that closeness, is that connection.
That's a very interesting thought. Let me answer it by trying to chart what might be a process of empathic relation. I apprehend, I use that vague word, I apprehend somebody else is in a condition of serious distress. I engage in some way with that distress by saying, I wish to be alongside in that distress in whatever way might be of use to you. I hope and trust that in that moment, the other understands, apprehends something of my perception of their distress as not completely empty or false or delusive. And thus, in the accompaniment of another in their distress, something is created which binds us, which gives us a language, Now, I would say that the problem with some versions of empathy is that that process of shaping a shared language, a shared world, is short-circuited in any number of ways, and even worse, aborted, so to speak. I go in and say, oh, I understand how you feel. And the other says, no, you don't. And there, the shared world breaks down. And there are moments when I speak as a pastor here, you know, I have had that response. So, no, you have no idea what I'm going through. Don't pretend. You are saying that. You clearly have an interest in attempting to accompany me, but for purposes I can't divine and which may be self-serving. So go away. Now, that works, I think, both at individual and corporate level. For typically, as was said earlier, the advantaged or powerful agent to say to the disadvantaged or disempowered agent, I feel your pain. Homi, you were talking about this in the introduction.
Yes. Yeah.
The disadvantaged, dispossessed person has every right to say, no, you don't, because if you did, dot, dot, dot. The accompaniment is unreal. There is no shared language. And therefore, whatever emotional affect I pour out towards the other serves me rather than the other and ceases or fails to provide a shared world. I was thinking about this watching 12 Years a Slave recently, and Benedict Cumberbatch's character, clearly wanting to be sympathetic to his slave. And it's not possible. The structure makes it impossible, and therefore it's a delusion to do that. If that relationship itself is challenged and changed, if the first agent steps out of that role in a significant and effective way, something may happen. But I think it's very interesting that the idea that there is a sort of reciprocity of understanding created there. There is a recursive or reflexive empathy around, insofar as the sufferer understands that there is an attempt being made to understand, and therefore something more emerges.
Could I ask a question on this very point? Isn't one of your points that that what interferes with the empathic, I don't know, contract, but what with the relation is the projection of the ego, is the egotistical projection of my conditions, my values, my norms. But precisely to stop that, then you not only have to displace it from yourself, but in doing that, you also shift the egotistical projection coming from the other side.
Yes.
And then something is revealed which allows the relation which allows the empathy to flow in both directions.
Absolutely. I think that's right. The degree to which an effective action of compassion releases not only me from my empathic, from my egotistical projection, but the other from an imprisoning self-identification as victim becomes significant here. Mm-hmm.
Yep, thank you. David?
No, thank you.
We have a question here, and then we're going up.
Yeah. Hi. Oh, that's loud. My name is Vivian Taylor. I'm the executive director of Integrity USA, the national gay, lesbian, bi, and trans organization for the Episcopal Church. This has been such a fascinating discussion of empathy and systems of power. I was wondering, based on what y'all are talking about here, if you might have any comment on the current Archbishop Justin Welby's comments last week on the acceptance by the Anglican Church in America and possibly in England of gay people and the celebration of gay marriage. He said that is causing mass killings in Africa. He claimed to have stood by a mass grave of more than 300 people who had been killed, 300 Christians who had been killed because their neighbors were afraid that they were somehow gay or going to cause them to be gay. And to some, including me, it seemed like this was an odd attempt to try to use empathy for one group of people to try to sustain discrimination against another group of people. What do you think about this whole, about those comments in this situation?
Thank you. I have a policy of not commenting on my successors' statements. You will understand why. But let me come at the substantive question, which is a very searching one. I think it won't do to use empathy in one direction to reduce empathy in another direction. That seems to me axiomatic. I think there is an agenda that needs addressing here, in that the resistance of some people in other parts of the Anglican family to the acceptance of LGBT people has something to do with the sense that they are being put at risk by other people's decisions. And one has at least, I think, to have some intelligent engagement with that perception, whether or not it's an accurate perception, but that it's a fact, I think, that I've heard it anyway from Africans who say, we are being put at risk by your decisions. Now, I don't think that should dictate our decisions, but it sets an agenda for the conversation that has to unfold. And I think it's in those circumstances just as important to say to the African sister or brother, can you also see how some of your decisions put people at risk unsought in our context? So attitudes towards LGBT people which, let's say, encourage or make easier homophobic abuse or suicide, young people's suicide, you know, that there is blood on the hands there too. So that's where I'd want to take that. I don't think, because as I said earlier, empathy doesn't decide the policies, but that's the conversation I'd want to open up. And the moral weight of the African experience, you are putting us at risk, has to be factored in to the conversation in which we, if we build up enough trust, are able to say, well, you know, you put us at risk too. But it should not be the kind of zero-sum game it often is, or the alibi-creating game it sometimes is.
Thank you. My name's a voice from on high for the Archbishop. My name's Michael Fraser. I'm an associate professor of government, and my question seems kind of academic after the last one, but I guess that's my job. I was kind of disappointed that you skipped the 18th century to get straight to the 21st, and the 20th, 18th, 20th, 21st. Because even though the term empathy hadn't been coined yet, a concept can exist long before the term we currently use to identify it. And it really did seem to be a uniquely rich time for understanding the issues that you're wrestling with. Not only Adam Smith, who you mentioned, and I do think his notion that the way to justly resolve conflict is through what he called divided sympathy, equally considering the perspective of each party to the conflict and their resentments, and I think you were exhibiting that just now. But also Herder, who's widely credited with coining the German term Einfühlung, and is also widely credited for being the first person to use culture in the plural. Yeah. And it would be odd if empathy were somehow by its nature blind to culture when the two concepts have the same point of origin. It's not just a coincidence. Herder argued, and it's really perhaps the best defense of the humanities ever written, and we could use some right now, that feeling one's way into the perspective of the life of the spirit of someone very, very different from oneself culturally or otherwise requires that we bring all our imaginative and interpretive resources that we can and struggle through that emotional, imaginative, interpretive, and rational process. And that's why we need history and literature and anthropology and all of that. But just because something is very difficult and never can succeed completely doesn't mean that there isn't huge moral value to the attempt to approach that ideal asymptotically. So that I think the lesson from the 18th century, whether it's situations of conflict where we're seeking justice, which Adam Smith describes very well, or situations of cultural difference where we're seeking intercultural understanding, which Herder describes very well, is that it's disrespectful and presumptuous and false to show up and say, I understand exactly how you feel. But it's equally defeatist and in its own way disrespectful to simply say, I have no idea how you feel, with the implication that I'm not going to really try. That the appropriate thing to say is to say, I don't currently fully understand how you feel, but I'm going to do my darndest to figure it out by using all the cognitive, emotional, imaginative resources I have at my disposal. Will you help me to do that? And that really is the task that Herder sees as the task of humanistic scholarship.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your statement.
Thank you. Let me respond briefly. As Dr. Johnson once responded to one of his questioners when asked why he'd made a mistake in the dictionary, he said, ignorance, madam, stark ignorance. I'm not, I don't pretend to be an 18th century expert, and I'm aware of Smith and indeed of Herder in a way which makes me realize I need to fatten that out as background. So that's just an apology for ignoring that. And I hope I can claim to have ignored it consciously rather than unconsciously. But more importantly, let's take this question of, I've no idea how you feel. I'm obviously being a bit mischievous there and saying that the thing to say to somebody else is, I've no idea how you feel. I don't think we stop there. And that's why I'd go back to what I was saying earlier about the kind of language that emerges in an encounter where you begin by saying, I don't know, but help me here. The I've no idea how you feel is not so much a statement of despair as an invitation in the way I conceive it. And I think Herder's model is exactly where I'd want to be in terms of defending the humanities. I think that is precisely the utterly indefeasible and necessary task of the humanities in our intellectual world, and we are rapidly, as a culture and as a political culture, forgetting that. So I'm with you all the way in terms of affirming the Herderian crossover, if you like, between Einführung and the plurality of cultures, and that sense that the strangeness of a remote world is not a problem or a closed book, but an agenda in some way.
Dave?
Oh.
You want to pass on that?
I think so. I'm a little puzzled by the statement about we should go back to the 18th century. The example given of Herder is a very admirable one. I've always liked Herder. But it seems to me so obvious that, especially with the history of effects of Adam Smith, are not exactly purely positive. And even some of the history of effects of Herder in German culture are not purely positive. So that as happy as I am to retrieve good figures, and I like Adam Smith on moral sentiments, and I like Herder on almost everything, it seems to me to slide around so many crucial issues that in the 21st century and late 20th, we've had a better chance of being able to pose than anyone in the 18th century was able to pose, including what I was referring to with the various critical theories now available to help one think quite seriously, for example, in the 18th century, about the colonialism which is going on during the Enlightenment and the imperialism that is occurring all over the West at that period. So that, like all other things on the 18th century, you need a hermeneutics of retrieval to be sure of the admirable things that occurred. You also, for example, the American founders did many admirable things, but you also need a hermeneutics of critique. That is to say, there are certain things that seem to me obviously wrong, and moreover, and more importantly, a hermeneutics of suspicion about unconscious. It's a very important distinction, in my opinion, between conscious errors, which the Enlightenment dealt with, and the post-Enlightenment, Marx, Freud, Nietzsche, feminist theory, colonial theory, et cetera, which is a very different agenda and a more fruitful one, in my opinion, of being able finally to begin to deal with unconscious but systemically functioning, especially through structures of society, as Rowan has emphasized, distortions, self-delusions, delusions, not mere errors that Herder was innocent about, and is not to charge him as if this is a bad thing. I always thought Adorno was perfectly right. There is no innocent culture. There is no innocent tradition. There isn't even an innocent reading of any text that you could mention, including Adam Smith on moral sentiments and Herder on culture.
It's enough. I think we're going to take the last
two quick comments on that, if I may.
Please.
Just very briefly. I'm fascinated by the way in which aspects of Adam Smith are now being retrieved by interpreters in a way which I think demonstrates very clearly that the use made of him 20, 30 years ago, his conscription into Chicago economics, is a radical distortion of what he's about, and that the work of Robert Skidelsky on this has been particularly important. And indeed, just looking at Emma in the audience, likewise. The other point is mentioning again the book I quoted by Joanna Book on what it is to be human.
Oh, yes.
Has a really intriguing discussion of the ambivalence of the Enlightenment about what counts as human. And she begins from a pamphlet, a very, very early 19th century pamphlet by an anonymous woman, which argues satirically and ironically that animals have more protection in British law than women do. Mm-hmm. And what does that say about our perception, our apprehension
yes.
of the human? And it is a period where what you might call conditional humanitarianism is rife.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that some of the apologists against the slave trade really have to
yes, indeed.
Battle against.
And I think okay. to some extent, understanding ambivalence mm-hmm. is very much of our time. Understanding ambivalence, yes, not opposition, not polarization, not contradiction, mm-hmm. ambivalence, to love and to hate in the same time, in the same place. That is something, as a mode of critique, is, I think, something that I would say is of a more recent
sure.
provenance
sure.
and is very important, the question of ambivalence.
Would you agree, Homi, that, and the other side of that is ambiguity.
Yeah, the other side is ambiguity.
But
the two should not be confused.
People think ambiguity, ambivalence is my response,
yeah.
ambiguity is the phenomenon,
yeah.
which is, which I have to analyze. And ambiguity, in my opinion, most people hear the word and think negative. Ambiguity literally means it involves the true and the false, it involves the good and the evil, and if it's involved with religion, it involves the holy and the unholy. It's ambiguous, which is why we respond ambivalently. Yes?
To it, and yeah. it has its own power.
Yes.
Yeah.
Someone else? Yes.
Well, and first, thank you for this wonderfully rich and suggestive lecture. You've given us a critique of the privatized and sentimentalized understanding of empathy that is common and widespread, and you've shown that it misses the and fails to respect the strangeness of the other, and also rests on the on a false transparency of the self to itself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And all of that seems to me powerful and persuasive. My question is about what you take to be the subject of empathy or the self that is capable of empathy. You said a few times you used the word primordial, and that threw me off a little bit, puzzled me, because I thought when you referred to the primordial, you were referring to the embodied, individuated self as the default, the starting point for the project of empathy. And yet it would seem to fit better with your overall account that the subject of empathy or the self capable of empathy must be something other than the antecedently individuated self. Is that right?
Thank you. Yes, a really helpful question. First of all, primordial is very much Edith Stein's word,
mm-hmm.
and the way she uses it is for the, I think, the heuristically imagined bare perception of phenomena, which never really happens, but that is, I think, what she has in mind. Were we to have only primordial experience, we wouldn't have experience at all.
Mm-hmm.
So the self is indeed the embodied intelligence, the always already embodied, always already intelligent. And the self, which becomes both transparent and obscure to itself, is the self which, as Augustine memorably says, has become a question to itself, precisely because it doesn't just act from that imagined primordiality, that imagined simplicity. That is clarifying.
I want to thank both of you, Rowan Williams, Dave Tracy, for being here today. I want to thank the audience, and I want the takeaway line to be, all that is sayable is hearable. I think that is very important and profound, both for our for education, for the academy, for education, and for society behind beyond it. All that is sayable must be hearable. Thank you very much for that.